So I work in the mechanisms, maintenance, crew systems, and photo TV branch. It's a lot of words. We are responsible for a lot of different tasks and training, but I work for the International Space Station Program, which is down here in Houston, Texas, at the Johnson Space Center. And I'm a flight controller and instructor.
So you basically are working everybody's dream gig. Super cool.
So, it's funny you say that. So I remember my first level one of FATP throwback. It was a blast. I absolutely loved what I was doing. We were astronauts in training, and I was like, how do I get to do this for a job? And I had learned that there were people that actually train astronauts. I didn't know that starting into the camp, but at the end of the week, I had learned that. And I learned that if you go pursue an engineering degree, most likely, aerospace, mechanical, it doesn't have to be those, but those are the common ones, then you can be eligible to go apply for a job. And so that was from there. It was like freshman year of high school. That was the path that I pursued then through high school and college and co-oping to get here today.
That's so cool. And before we get to a couple of questions for young learners, just curious about your path. We were also going to ask you about your time at the Cosmosphere. What was it about your time at the Cosmosphere in camp that really inspired you to want to move into space and science as a full-time job?
I'm trying to think back. It was quite a long time ago now. But I think I, going through middle school and high school, I just started liking space a lot more because there's just so much new, every year, every day, both technical, but also I kind of have like a creative side too, and I feel like there's just so much that's new and different and to be explored. And so that kind of meshes with a creative personality. And I just experienced that at space camp and the teamwork that you have when you're doing your mission. I loved that. There's so much perseverance and challenge that you go through, a lot of communication that you have to exercise. Leadership, of course. So all of that, I just fell in love with it, and so then I just pursued everything I could going through, the next 10 years of school after that to get here.
So building on that, knowing that this was something that, was a passion area for you and you wanted to start to pursue a track towards getting into space and science, and knowing you needed to have an engineering degree, a lot of young learners are sort of faced with the challenge of knowing what they want to do, but they need to build effective habits day to day to be successful in a future field. So if you think back to your years at school, were there any habits that you found really useful as a student that you sort of integrated into your day-to-day life that maybe even still use today?
So even when you're in school, every day is different. That's how it is right now in my current job. Every day is different, which it's nice, but it also means you really got to know what your schedule is the next day. So I always every day here at work, I know what I'm doing the next day, and if suddenly if I'm a little behind, I know what I need to prep for to be ready for the next day at least. And I think that's important in college or high school or whatever grade. It just, that little bit of proactivity can just really help you be prepared and confident and ready for that next thing coming at you. And then prioritizing is also huge, especially when you get into high school and college and your full-time gig. Being able to split up projects into tasks and work backwards for a timeline.
So thank you for that. So working in that effective habit of starting to manage your time, with your position now, why is time management so important? And did you find that what you're doing to manage your time might be even similar to what you did as a student when you were kind of up and coming?
Yeah, we will have different types of projects. Some of them, that they're not happening for another 2 years. Maybe some aren't happening for 6 months. I'm a flight lead for a flight that's flying in February in G17. So you take those dates and you work backwards and you know what your milestones are or your different responsibilities or any open work. Those are sometimes the easier ones because they're further out. Sometimes we have something break on the space station and you're maybe a technical expert on it and it needs to be fixed in 2 days. And so then you have to have those priority discussions with your employee, with your other coworkers or your management, and you manage your time and your priorities of everything else you're working on to adequately find the right people, or you carve that space into your time to do what you need to do to have, you know, the toilet working suddenly, you know, again, something like that, whatever it is. So it changes so much, but it definitely makes you exercise those skills. And I'm trying to remember if in school, if we had anything that was, you know, like last minute, but definitely group projects, you would have to exercise some of those longer time management skills. Sometimes you could have an assignment crop up, maybe you forget about it and you gotta carve out that space real fast.
Well, totally. Yeah. And especially like when you're in school, you're like working with all these different activities and balancing, you know, requirements at home and that sort of thing.
Yeah.
So when you are in school and you know what you want to do and you're learning how to manage your time, how do you also stay motivated? Because, you know, there's a lot of like near-term goals with school, like I want to get an A in this class or mm-hmm. I want to win this football game. But how did you stay motivated and keep your eye on the ball to eventually work at NASA through all those years?
Yeah, so for me, it was pretty easy. I mean, it started out that first week of that space camp of just so much fun. Like, I was in tears leaving the camp. I didn't want to leave the camp. So that whole passion sounds so cheesy, but it was true. Like, that passion was there. It was planted. And so just, I always, like, there were classes I did not like in college as part of my degree, but I always just kept in mind that that degree at the end of it is what I am, my main goal is that end goal. So if I can just, you know, get through that class, chunk it up, make it happen, make it more achievable, and really focus on that end degree, you know, get your hiney down to Houston, that's what you want to do. That was my main motivator through college if I was having some tough days.
Thank you for sharing that. So building on like the experience you had at the Cosmosphere, and like I had the same experience, it's so overwhelming, right? When you leave and you're like, I just want to move to the hall of space and like hang out by the F1 all day. Like, what's that?
Put your sleeping bag down and
100%. Like, just why? We watched this one movie, The Dream is Alive, which was this IMAX film, and I think I saw it 100 times when I was working there. It's like, I will mm-hmm. still watch it just to reminisce on the times at the cause. So, thinking of like going big picture now for young learners, so folks who might be grade school, junior high school, that kind of thing, if they're watching this and they're like, man, I'm really into space and science and I want to do what Amanda does. What's your advice for them to eventually work at space and science and kind of do what they love?
Yeah, I'm glad you asked that. So I think the biggest thing that helped me was in high school, I did a couple different extracurriculars that were either math or science based, different clubs or different competitions. And I took a lot of different science classes. So that helped me you know more what I wanted to do in college. And then in college, I was in a sorority. And then I was also in a couple other engineering type extracurriculars. And then I also started getting co-op jobs as early as I could in the aerospace industry in Wichita. So all those things really helped me, I think, understand what I wanted. As I continued going through college and pursued a full-time career. But then also, I remember when I did my interview for my NASA co-op down here in Houston, I was like way back in 2009. I remember them being like, you have these different leadership positions and you're a sorority and these other extracurriculars. That's really great to see. They really liked seeing that I wasn't part of 10 things, but I was a part of like three or four things, and I was really involved in those three or four things. And I had some leadership positions in those couple of, it was like one or two of them at that time. So just really knowing what you want and then really taking advantage of those opportunities and having them help you grow to be what you want to be.
Thank you for that. So moving on to maybe some thoughts for business professionals. And as a side note, we want to give a shout out to Stefan at the Cosmosphere, who helped do a lot of the research and put together some of these questions. So these are some really exciting topics we want to cover. So big thanks to Stefan for the help there. So moving towards content for business professionals who, particularly over the past couple of years, are really isolated. They need to work with teams. They're trying to rapidly level up their skills building for collaborating, but also advancing their careers within their companies. And in many cases, just rethinking what they're doing. So we had some questions for you that might be useful for that particular audience and what they can learn from you around like actually working in mission control. So first off, question, you know, Apollo astronaut Gene Cernan, so from Apollo 17, described mission control as the feathers of an arrow guiding the astronauts to their destination. So as a flight controller, what's been your role to support the on-orbit operations of the ISS?
Yeah, so as a flight controller, I've done it. I've been certified for about 2.5 years now. And I am in the console that is the operations support officer. We shorten it by just calling it OSO. And my specialty when I sit there is I am responsible for maintenance, internal maintenance of the International Space Station. So if we have something simple that breaks, we help the crew members fix it. Or if we have something that we never expected to break in its lifetime, and we're gonna have to come up with some super creative way to fix it, that's my group, and that's me on console as well. It's the whole gamut of using that problem-solving process from everything that's easy to hard and in between. And then my group is also responsible for mechanisms. So the main one is how the different segments of the International Space Station connect together. As well as how some of the other vehicles, cargo and crew vehicles, attached to the space station. And then we also have a couple of subgroups that teach crew members how to take all the beautiful photographs that you see out on social media. Somebody trains them how to do that. Some of them have a natural ability for photography, but there is a lot of training that goes into that. And then we also have a couple of folks who teach the crew members how to live in space. So everything from, you know, showering, and which is not a real shower in space, but showering and using the bathroom and sleeping and brushing your teeth and how to make your food and all those daily things that become so much harder in space. And so when I'm sitting on console, I am the technical expert for maintenance, but then I'm also the representative for all those other aspects as well.
Thank you for that. That's fascinating. So you're working on problem-solving mechanisms, also part of the team that's training astronauts around living in space, taking these amazing photos that we see on social media. So thinking about when you're training the astronauts, you're mentioning that sometimes you're working even 2 years ahead of a launch target with the astronauts to train them. We know that they typically have very demanding training schedules. So as part of your job to train the astronauts, how do you develop a model when you're training the astronauts to decide what's most important to tell the astronauts without giving them too much information? So basically, how do you decide what's essential, also knowing that they might call you once they're in space to help them fix something?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So that 1.5 to 2 years once they're assigned, that it sounds like a lot of time, and it is a lot of time, but it's amazing how much additional training gets put into that time frame, because you have to remember they get selected as an astronaut candidate, and then they have about another, once they're selected, they get about 2 years of training to then become an actual applicable astronaut candidate to be assigned. Then after that, they have another 1.5 to 2 years. So it's a lot of training. So there is this huge template that is managed by a whole board. There's a lot of checks and processes that goes into what's trained and how much time is allocated to all that different type of training. But for us, for maintenance, we actually only get about 40 hours total with each crew member before they fly. And so we really focus on skill-based training instead of task-based training. So I teach an astronaut how to turn a wrench. I don't teach them how to turn a wrench on this specific thing. I need them to be able to turn a wrench on anything, maybe that they've seen, maybe that they've never seen, maybe that we never thought we would need to turn a wrench on before. They need to have that fundamental skill to be able to apply to anything that we ask them to fix.
That's fascinating. So you're focusing on these fundamental skills, on the skills, not necessarily the tactics, so that when you need to help them solve a problem, they understand what those bigger picture skills are, so then you can help work on the problem solving. Yeah. So I'm moving on to-
They do a lot of, we also teach them how to think as well, a problem solving process. So we in my group, we don't get a lot of data on our computers from our systems. A lot of our data is actually what their crew member is seeing and telling us, taking photos of, and them verbally, all their words that they use and how they say it really helps us understand the picture if they're running into a problem for an activity that they're working on. So that communication is huge, and that's something specifically in our group we really drive into them to practice on and work on during their whole training flow. And then of course, you know, when they're up there flying too.
When you're talking about the communication piece and the training, are you referring to how they might describe a problem happening that you'll then need to solve? So we saw an interview where you mentioned something that was really cool, which is a flight director might often say, okay, oh, so we have a problem, or we've got something to throw you today, or you're ready for this one. So we were curious about how you work together as a team on the ground to solve those problems, and then maybe even what you've trained them to communicate with you, because that listening piece is also really interesting to us as well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So for flight controllers, when we go through our couple years of simulation training before we're certified, we are ingrained with this communication template that is called the FIW process. So failure, impact, workaround. So you have a problem, but there's a lot of different failures that could be causing that problem. So you need to identify what those failures are. And then you need to understand the impact to the problem that's occurring. If the impact, you know, if it doesn't matter for another month, then maybe I don't need to worry about it today. We just move on. But if it affects them being able to sleep tonight, that's a big deal. And so making sure that you talk that impact is huge. And then you get down to the workarounds. And it can be super obvious things that could fix the problem, or it can be really out of the box ideas that fix the problem. And so any problem that we run into, any flight controller that you see in mission control or flight director, they're all gonna be thinking through this process. And it is just a template for us to easily and quickly communicate what we're thinking. And you also roll in risk to what you recommend as the final solution. And so that flight director is listening for that specific template. And so it's like a language that we use in mission control to solve a problem, and then make sure that we are hitting all the right information across the board, across the world. Even international partners, when they have a problem, they use that template to the flight director.
So with the FIW, the failure impact workaround, how do you identify time constraints then? And are there situations where you literally need to solve problems in 2 or 3 minutes versus a couple hours? Like how does that work in terms of the timeline that you have to kind of come together and problem solve as a team?
Yeah, so every time is very subjective, but we always have this priority, again, back to priority, safety of the crew, safety of the vehicle, and then mission success. And that order can help you understand time to effect. Also, sometimes it's just depending on what it is, it can be really easy to understand time to effect. But maybe crew finished a lot of their activities early in the day, so you have extra time. So maybe you actually do have time to fix this problem that maybe doesn't have to be fixed today, but you have the time and everybody is in agreement of what needs to be done. So it is so many different factors, but it's just this whole conversation and teamwork across the entire team with a lot of different factors. And it's the crew time, it's what's going on that day. It's if you have certain activities coming up, maybe you just say no, we're gonna let it go and we're gonna revisit it once everybody can put some better brain cells to it.
That's very cool. And then speaking, you know, tactically towards specific tools that you might have on the ground that can help. So we're talking about communication tools, but thinking of like the actual physical tools, like a wrench or a screwdriver or something. Mm-hmm. Also saw that you had brought up the Apollo 13, you know, improvised solution, the square peg and the round hole, mm-hmm. with those tools in the ground. And then also showing, I think there was a screenshot or a photo of an actual toolbox with some drawers with a number of different tools. I wonder if you could tell us about sort of the approach to having tools at the ready to help the astronauts at the space station problem solve, and how you use that, and then how they communicate back and forth with you as you create a solution.
Yeah, so we, in the grand scheme of things, we don't have a whole lot of tools, but we have a toolbox. It has five different drawers. We also have a couple different power tools, like a drill that you would find in your own garage at home. And a lot of those hand tools are pretty common tools. If you're somebody that likes to work on your car, you'll probably have a lot of the same tools that the astronauts have on board. And when hardware is being developed and when payload science experiments are being developed to go to ISS, we try to get involved early just to make sure that everybody is trying to utilize fastener interfaces that work with what we already have. So that's just so much more efficient for space and for crew who already know what tools they have. But it's a lot of your common tools like wrenches and hex heads, is what we call them, or Allen keys, different kinds of pliers. We have some electrical repair hardware. We can do soldering on board. We have some fun tools like hammers and pry bars that we fortunately don't use too often, but you know, sometimes we have to pull them out. We do use a lot of fasteners for our hardware, and you know, just over time after you install and remove a fastener, they get worn. So we have screw extraction tools, and again, we don't have to use those too often, but sometimes we do. So those are a lot of the biggies that we have.
Cool. That's very cool. Thanks for kind of going through there. What's that?
Did that answer your question?
It absolutely did. Thank you. It's super helpful because we were talking earlier, you know, in the prep for this, that it's interesting that you can almost re-simulate a scenario. So there's all this training that goes in to prepare astronauts for living and working in space. But it's also interesting that there's the preparation needed to simulate and improvise a solution if something mm-hmm. does come up.
Yeah, and we write procedures for every activity that they do. It's a standardized template, again, standardized mm-hmm. template that we do for their procedures. And we call out what tools we think they need. And we tell them, you know, here's what fastener we're talking about. All of that just to also assist them. And we try to vet everything on the ground because their time is very sought after. So if we can make our instructions for them very efficient and correct, that is how we can be really good at our job, our responsibility.
Very cool. I have a few more questions here for you. So switching gears, it hasn't happened yet, but if an astronaut were to ever become untethered and tumble out into space, there's a device called SAFER that will arrest their movement and allow them to return to the spacecraft. So you got to help contribute to this amazing jetpack. I was wondering if you could describe your work on SAFER, maybe what your involvement with the project was and any perspectives you might have.
Yeah, so that was actually my second co-op rotation. I'm learning that wherever you pulled these questions from, I should probably update my resume on them. If it was LinkedIn or something. A long time ago. I haven't needed to update all that in a long time. So I did, and I was testing a new inertial measurement unit in IMU in the SAFER. It was like a new version of the SAFER that they were developing. And just making sure that the hardware worked as expected before it was put into the SAFER and flown, so that it would work properly if in that contingency scenario during a spacewalk, if a crew member became untethered and needed to use the SAFER. So that was my part in it. It was quite a long time ago, so I honestly don't remember a lot of the details, but I will tell you, bonus answer, that co-op rotation gave me so much clarity on what I wanted to do moving forward, because it was my second rotation. My first one was in flight operations with a different group. It was the motion control system group. And so I was in mission control a lot. I was learning about real-time operations. And then my second tour was the engineering equivalents, basically, of that group working with GPS and inertial measurement units. And I sat at that desk all summer long staring at mission control, and I couldn't go inside of it because that wasn't part of my role. And I just knew that I was meant for flight operations after that rotation. So, and I was doing a lot of like MATLAB and coding, which is not my passion at all. So I can do it. I just don't like to do it. Gave me a lot of clarity on what I wanted to do, but still a lot of appreciation on what the engineering side does, because that's, of course, absolutely important as well.
Thank you for that. Thanks for going into the Wayback Machine with us. That's great. We appreciate it. That's an earlier project, and thanks for your perspectives. And very cool that it led to more of a focus towards you getting towards, you know, flight operations. It's really cool. So since Apollo 17 in 1972, we haven't been back to the moon, but in that time we've created new technologies that can help in guidance and navigation, such as the global positioning system known as GPS. So a question for you, could GPS help the Orion capsule during the Artemis missions? And can you describe your work in helping to make that happen?
Yeah, so I'm not working on commercial crew quite yet, and still just fully ISS. However, I do know that any vehicle that's flying these days, they use GPS. And I mean, GPS is in our phones, it's on the Amazon drones, they're delivering packages, it's everywhere. So yeah, absolutely. And it, from what I've heard, that it helps us find those capsules really, really quickly as well when they come back to the ground. And it's part of our everyday these days.
Very cool. Yeah, we all live by it, right? Mm-hmm. Yep, this is important stuff. These are what the maps are made of. So thank you for that. So question for you going big picture. There have been a few astronauts who started in mission control and then applied and were eventually selected to be an astronaut. Have you thought about applying to be an astronaut? And is that in your future at some point?
So my answer for you probably used to be yes, if you rewound 10 years ago. But I'm actually not eligible right now to apply. I don't have a master's. That is a requirement, or at least it has been for the past two rounds of applications. But I actually was able to participate in a little bit of the interview process for this most recent class. And so I know they go through grueling interviews. I train a lot of them. I was actually training a lot of them today. And so I've seen that side of it. And I'm pretty happy just being in the operations side of it here on the ground and for where I'm at in my life.
That
That's a
is so
long way to say
interesting.
no. No, but I'm also not eligible right now.
That is so interesting. Thanks for sharing. You know, having worked on like both sides of the camera as an actor and then director, I always say like the best acting class you can ever take is to attend a casting session and watch people audition all day, right? Because you did get to see sort of how people are presenting themselves. So having had that perspective, this is kind of a bonus audible question. Just curious about your perspective on being part of the selection process. Is there any advice you have for folks who might be looking to apply to be an astronaut, having been a part of that application process?
Yeah, so they have a huge application process, and the part that I do is one small piece, and I can't probably give you very many details about it. But I would say a lot of the people that I saw coming through this most recent round, they just, yeah, it's like back to what I was saying earlier, just being well-rounded in your personality and your experiences and how you work with people as a team. Like that's just huge. I think teamwork, the teamwork piece is absolutely huge. But then just also just in general, all of us, I think any of us when we're applying to a job, they're looking for how do you deal with stress and how are you just as a person to work with people. So all those different kinds of factors.
That's very cool. Thank you for that. And you know, knowing that we're coming up, we're talking about Apollo 17 next year in 2022, which is actually going to be in the same month as the 60th anniversary of the Cosmosphere, if you can believe it. So Cosmosphere is going to be celebrating its 60th anniversary. So there's a lot of really fun activities and events coming up in prep for a pretty huge celebration on December 2nd of next year. So mark your calendar for that. So was curious if you had a message for anybody out there who might be seeing this, who's considering going to camp, considering checking out the Cosmosphere resources online, obviously had a very big impact on us on this video meeting here. Any advice you have for folks out there who are thinking of taking the leap and attending a camp?
Yeah, I mean, definitely do it. I don't think anybody would ever regret going to space camp because it is just so much fun. I made so many good friends when I was a am I losing the word? When I worked there. Help me out, guys.
Like as a counselor or
Counselor,
a
thank you.
counselor, great.
Counselor, I don't know when counselor didn't come to my head. Yeah, I made so many good friends when I was working there as a counselor and just had a blast as a camper. Like even to the point where I remember I helped out when level 4 and level 5 even existed. I remember saying, I will come be a counselor for you. You don't have to pay me. I'll just pay for my trip and I'll go and I'll be free labor. Like I loved that. So anyway, yeah, I don't think anybody will regret it. It is such a blast to go on, and and then I would just say, just work hard and don't let people tell you no, right? You can tell yourself no. I wouldn't recommend it, but don't let other people tell you no. Just put your head down and work really hard, and you can achieve anything you put your mind to.
Thank you for that. Yes, Mimi, Meredith, we're going to throw to Mimi
All right.
for additional thoughts here.
Oh, well, thank you. First of all, Amanda, I was going to sit here and try and be perfectly silent, but I want to go back to when you were talking about the candidates you interviewed, and I totally get your need to not reveal too much, but just you personally in that workplace where describing a problem from the International Space Station that you're trying to fix on the ground and anything that might even happen around you in mission control. When you said you look for the ways that people handle stress, can you just dive into that a little bit and tell me what you think some good habits are that can lead to being prepared for stressful moments and then how to respond to them in a way that doesn't, jeopardize a mission, whether that's whatever team you're on?
Yeah, so I'll kind of answer it more for what we do, like in crew training, once we have crew assigned and everything. So So something that we super, super prepare for are emergencies. And crew does a lot of emergency training, and that's a different group for the most part. But we do, my group does participate sometimes, but they always have this potted response, because that's all going to be a really stressful scenario if you have a fire or a depress, something like that. So they have these potted responses that they practice over and over, so that when that stress moment hits, they just innately know what to do. Other times, we teach the crew members to just initially big picture, understand what their task is so that they understand how much time they have, where it is, what's the purpose of the task. And having all that, I think, can help out with stress. And kind of like what I was talking about before, looking ahead and being proactive, that helps me relieve stress sometimes at work. What do I need to do 2 days out and back up and be ready for that type of event? And that just, me personally, removes some of those stress triggers, I guess I would call them sometimes, right? And we, within our group, I mean, again, we train for multiple years before we're certified flight controllers, as an example. And so we do these simulations where we run through a lot of different scenarios, and we practice a lot doing that FIW process. We don't, do great all the time. That's the purpose of the training, so that you mess up in the training event, that way that you do properly respond and safely respond when the real event happens real time. So there's a lot of different mitigations that we do and cover in training, whether it's astronaut or flight controller training.
You know, Amanda, we just hear about the simulations and the training, and especially from some of the Apollo era flight controllers. And I just was sitting here listening to you talk about that and wished that in real, well, not you are experiencing real life, but in everyday life that's not associated with the space program, I wish there were simulations. I wish I got to practice a little crisis before it happened. But I think some of the characteristics that you explained are perfect and help regardless of whether you've been through it all.
You mentioned the simulations. I remember at space camp, we would do the simulations. It'd be like the low-fi mock-up and then the high-fi mock-up. Then you'd go do the real thing. So it was like that, and you went through the practice. And if you're more comfortable with whatever that scenario is, that helps you with the stress, or helps you get the jitters out. But it's fun. It's a lot of fun sometimes to think back to that, how some of it is still so similar. Some of it's not, some of it is very similar to some of what we have to do right now. And I think about some of the people who now work down here, and it's just so cool to think that it started all back at the Cosmosphere, and those friendships are, still down here in Houston, or different people across the U.S. working in different places. So, yeah, it's amazing. I had a boss who uses this terminology. Our group that we have that I'm in, because we work with so many different groups on so much different hardware, it's a really good gateway for a lot of people to move to different positions, up and out with the space station program or other program. Our boss used to say, we're increasing our sphere of influence is what he would call it. And so that's what I think of when, for the Cosmosphere, you have all these campers and counselors and directors who move on, but you're all over the US, which it's just so cool.
It's a really good point. It's a pretty cool network of mm-hmm. folks who have gone through this shared experience. Mm-hmm. And it really does mirror that process. I mean, thinking of even the Falcon simulator, right? You mm-hmm. know, and the mock-ups and and going through the scripts and the procedures. It's mm-hmm. pretty fascinating. Thank you so much for sharing your time, Amanda and Mimi, for setting this whole thing up.